peace and love to the poor of Iraq, both Christian and Muslim. Mother Olga came to the United States in 2001, where she became involved in college campus ministry. In 2011, Cardinal Sean O'Malley entrusted her with the mission of establishing a new religious community of sisters in the Archdiocese of Boston. It is with great honor and love that we welcome to the podium today, Mother Olga Yakov.
Number 5147, announcing this very special day, the National Sanctity of Human Life Day. It's a great joy and honor for me to be with all of you to celebrate and honor this very day, the National Sanctity of Human Life Day. This proclamation was signed by former President Ronald Reagan on January 13, 1984. I would like to read part of it. Because of that day, you and I are here today to celebrate, to honor, and to pray for life. Part of it reads, quote, "The values and freedoms we cherish as Americans rest on our fundamental commitment to sanctity of human life, the first of the inalienable rights affirmed by our Declaration of Independence is the right to life itself. A right, the Declaration states, has been endowed by our Creator on all human beings, whether young or old, weak or strong, healthy or handicapped. Now, therefore, I, Ronald Reagan, President of the United States of America, do hereby proclaim Sunday, January 22nd, 1984, as a National Sanctity of Human Life Day. I call upon the citizens of this blessed land to gather on that day in homes, places of worship, to give thanks for the gift of life, to reaffirm our commitment to the dignity of every human being and to the sanctity of every human life." End of quote. Wow. This is a proclamation by one of our own former president of this blessed land to protect the human right of every human person, and begins with the gift of life. And sisters, as you witnessed just a few minutes ago, we are here not because we are against of anyone. We are here not because we deny anyone's right. We are here to stand for the truth. The truth that is given to every human soul from the moment of conception to the natural death. And that truth is right to life. And that is happiness when this proclamation read and signed by our former president in 1984. I wonder how many our fellow citizens in this country know that today is a national day for celebrating the sanctity of life. Whether young or old, born or unborn, healthy or handicapped, it's a day that we all should celebrate as fellow citizens, the sanctity of human life. Just last week, we celebrated in this very blessed land and honored an icon for human rights, Dr. Martin Luther King. And this is another quote from him. He is celebrated and honored as a man who fought for human rights, and rightly so, to be honored for that. But we have been a culture and a society, what I call a salad bar. We pick and choose what we want. If we truly want to honor Martin Luther King, the icon who fought for human rights, we should get to know him in all that he said and fought for. And the most important thing for him was, is the gift of life. And I read this quote from him. If we are to have peace on earth, we must be concerned about the sacredness of all human life. Every person is a child of God, made in his image, and must be respected as such. End of quote. St. John Paul II, the first time the term of culture of life was used, before even the encyclical, the Gospel of Life, was written, it was on this very soil, in America, in 1993, during the World Youth Day, when he came to Denver. He invited the young people of this country, of this culture, to be witnesses to the Gospel of Life. The theme of that World Youth Day was, I came that you might have life and have it abundantly, and encourage the young people of America to be witnesses to life and change this culture to the culture of life. For the first time was used for us here in this very land. In recent years, in recent times more so, we have heard people talking about human rights, and it's important to think of these terms. I come from a part of the world where people didn't have many rights, with a right to freedom, right to religion. I know what it means to live in times or a country where there is a dictatorship. It is important for people to have that attitude of understanding, believing, and searching for their human rights. But my brothers and sisters, let's not be confused. The foundation of searching for any human right begins first with the right to life. Because let us be honest with ourselves. If the person is not born first, when the other rights will come from? First from life, right to life. And then we seek the right for religious, the right for equality. Don't take me wrong. I want people to have right for equality. Equality of men and women, equality of religious, equality of people of different nations and nationalities. Our country is such a rich country. We are a land of immigrants. I want our that everyone would feel has a right here as a fellow citizen. But if we don't defend the right of the unborn first, and the weak, and the vulnerable, and the elderly, and the dying, everything else, it will be different. I will share with you, my brothers and sisters, few experiences, how for me, there are few things that are what you hear in today's world. They say, maybe faith and country has to be separated, or faith and science, they don't meet. I will share with you some of the experiences, how for me, all these things have met in my life. I am a woman of faith, but I am a woman of science too. I studied biology and hematology with concentration on human physiology. And I was in my first year of medical school before the first Gulf War started in my country. I was pursuing medical school. And I always share with a lot of medical students and doctors in medical field, the more I studied science, the more I studied human physiology, the more I pursued my studies in medical school, the more I saw the hand of God in the way that we have been created. I do believe that God uses science to help us in all the development that we have in technology and science and treatments and medical needs. But these have to work together for the goodness of human beings, not against. The second thing, people think that we have to separate what we believe, or they think that, oh, this is all about religion, it's all about faith, leave your faith for yourself. And the government offices or laws or legislations, that's a different thing. That's not true either. That's not true either. I love my country so much. But the more I love my country, the more I work for life. Because it saddened me, very often I teach that my own daughters in the community as part of their formation. We have to love this country, we have to love this land, and we have to work for the life of this land. If we don't work for pro-life, what would happen of America 50 years from now? What would happen to the children of this nation? What would happen to our people? If we don't protect the dignity of marriage, if we don't protect the dignity of life, what would happen to our country, my brothers and sisters? This land that we take pride when we sing to our flag, to our forefathers, what would happen to our country 50 years from now, 100 years from now? If we don't promote life, work for life, for dignity of marriage, dignity of human life. To be pro-life, it means to be pro-America. And to be pro-America, it means to be pro-life. These two are not separated, my brothers and sisters. We have to pray for our governments, for our leaders. Some of you have heard this from me before. Since the election, when we had many people were running for the office, when I became citizen in 2008, they gave me a small flag the day that I took the oath. When there were so many people from both parties running for presidency, I told my daughters in the convent, we will light a vigil candle for our country. 24/7, just we have a sanctuary candle in the chapel, we'll light a candle for our flag, for God's protection upon our nation. Whoever will be our president, We have a responsibility to pray for our country, to pray for our leaders. I prayed on the day of inauguration, and I prayed for yesterday's march. I pray for peace and unity in our country. We need to change the culture. We have to pray, as we did a few minutes ago. Saint Therese, the little flower, used to say, "The power of prayer works miracles." Saint Paul said, "We have to be witnesses in season and out of season." To be pro-life witnesses, it's not just in the month of January, when we approach this anniversary. We have to be witnesses of life, and genuine witnesses of life, in all stages of life, and joyful witnesses of life, in all stages of life, wherever we are, in order to change our culture. So people would know, we are not here fighting. I don't like this word, fight. We are here proclaiming. Proclaiming the gift of life. Proclaiming, not fighting. We are here proclaiming the gift of life that is given by God. And we are proclaiming His goodness. It's a proclamation of what the Lord has given us. What I have learned, my brothers and sisters, in my own journey of proclaiming the gift of life, the gift of the gospel, the gift of God the Creator, I want to share these also true stories with you. How in every stage you see the power of witness and proclamation can change people's life. When I have been to labor with many women, as biologist and through ministry, many women in Iraq and here, and not necessarily those who are Christian or Catholic, I go with them to labor, I pray with them, and I stay with them. I remember just this past spring, I witnessed birth of 6 babies. 4 of them were from the shelter. And 2 of them were very difficult pregnancies and difficult labor. One of them, I had to be with her in the hospital for 3 days. And she wasn't even Christian. I remember in the hospital, they kept asking me, "Mother, you should leave, you should go. You know, we know that her situation is difficult, but we can call you when we need you. You should go. It's not going to happen today. Probably it won't happen tomorrow." And I said, "No, I brought her here. I came here. I will stay with her until the baby is born." Because she came from the shelter. She didn't have a family, and the boy didn't have a father. The child didn't have a father. And the 3rd day, I had a speaking engagement outside the state, and I already had a ticket. And I called and I canceled my flight and my event. And everyone was shocked in the hospital. I said to them, "That event, I can find another one to speak. But this woman and this child, all that she has in me." They couldn't understand it still. I stayed with her all through her labor, until the child was born. I said to them, "I wanted her to feel that she is chosen. She is chosen. The woman is chosen. The child is chosen." As I said earlier, we are pro-life not because we are against of anyone. It's the opposite. We are pro-women. We are pro-child. And that witness to life have changed many medical personnel too, from attending many labors here in many hospitals here in Boston. From Brigham and Women, Boston Medical Center, Newton, Wellesley, Beth Israel, I go to all these hospitals with women. Another experience I had, another birth. And in the middle of birth, they thought they lost a child, and they had called emergency C-section. And I knelt at the front of the emergency room when they rushed her to have a C-section, until they brought me the gown to change to be able to go in with her. They knew, all the medical people whom I have worked with for life, they have seen and they know that is not a tissue, it's a child, it's a life. And they count on the prayer to save that life. I remember when that child was born and they weren't sure if the child was breathing, the doctor turned to me, he said, say prayers, say prayers. Until they heard the sound. And they said, we got him, he's still with us. If it was a tissue, why they rushed? Why they were fighting? With all the machines and all the medical supplies they had, and equipments to make sure they will make it. But they knew there was a person there. There was a life. There was an individual. I have seen many changes in people's life, including medical personnel. When they see a genuine witness that we care not because only for those who are Christian or Catholics. We care not only when we are asked. For me, this message of life has taught me to care for all God's people. Just a few weeks ago, I was called to a hospital to visit a Muslim man who didn't speak English. And I found out he was a religious leader in his own country. He was brought up here for cancer treatment. When I visited with him, and I continued to visit with him the last few weeks until he finishes his treatment at the end of this month before he leaves, he has his own mosque in his country because, as I said, he's a religious leader in his religion. Even his family was surprised why I have made such a commitment to come and visit him regularly and even bring him Middle Eastern food that he would feel connected to his country. He's not from Iraq, he's not from my own land. I told him, it's my faith and my belief in life teaches me equality between all God's people. But it's the unborn, the gift of life that teaches me to see the equality in God's people. Really, my brothers and sisters, go out and proclaim this truth. If we want to see equality in our culture, gender equality, religion equality, all the other rights that people are talking about in today's time in our country, it has to begin first with the right to life. That is what I have learned. I have served with equality men and women of every faith background, of every religion, young and old. One day I met a young woman. I met her outside a chapel after she was raped. She was confused and crying. When I took her to the emergency room and then to the police department, and I stayed with her for 2 days, everyone was surprised. They asked me if I was a family member or a friend. And I said, no, I just met her on the street. Again, the dignity of the human person, it didn't matter where I met her or how long I knew her. For me, she was important because of the gift of life that we see in every person. A few months ago, I picked an addicted person, a homeless person. When I took him to the emergency room, and I had to call 25 detox program to find him a bed, I remember one person called me and said, Mother, it's raining and you've been all day out with this person. When are you going to come home? Sometimes these people have no hope for them. Just give up and come home. And I said, no. As long as I remember Saul became Paul, I cannot give up hope. But again, for me, it's the same message, my brothers and sisters. It is the gift of the unborn that has taught me to love and care for all God's people. It is the right to life in the child that has taught me to proclaim the right and the dignity of every person, whether the young raped woman or the addicted homeless man, or the woman from the shelter, or the Muslim man who is battling cancer in the hospital. For me, it's all the same, because they all have the same breath of life given by the same creator, giver of life. And it's the witness and the commitment to that message what will change our culture. So let us go out joyfully, trusting in the power of prayer that works miracles, proclaiming the message of life, that we are here doing what we are doing, not because we are against anybody, but we are for God, for life, and for people. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning.